Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents We Cry Justice, Reading the Bible with the Poor People's Campaign, edited by Liz Theoharis. Foreword by William J. Barber II, narrated by Kim Niemi. Foreword. When I was growing up, sometimes the preacher was so clearly preaching truth from the Bible and challenging the ways of sin and injustice that somebody would say, "Cry loud, Reverend, cry loud." In We Cry Justice, Reading the Bible with the Poor People's Campaign, Reverend Dr. Liz Theoharis and the other writers whose work is included in these chapters know how to cry for justice. In a skillful and insightful way, they instruct us, through the biblical witness, how to cry. They recognize that crying loud, crying out against injustice, is, according to the Bible, non-negotiable. This powerful book truly took me down memory lane. My grounding as a child was in a family of church leaders and social activists who saw no separation between the two. My father and mother were both active participants in the civil rights transformation and in the church. So when I consider what it means to read the Bible, my mind travels back to many of the things I heard expressed during my upbringing in the faith. I'm the son of a pastor who was a general evangelist of our denomination. In other words, my father was often sent to build new congregations. Many times this began with a few people gathering for a Bible study. My mother was and is a church musician. She's a skilled hymnologist. When I accompanied her to choir rehearsal, I saw that she not only taught the hymns, but also showed people that every hymn had a scriptural reference that undergirded the theological foundation. My mother taught more than the notes and the words in her rehearsals. She taught the Bible. I come from a tradition in which vacation Bible school was inviolable in the summer. Sunday school was as important as morning worship, and memorization of scripture was an important discipline in our spiritual development. In the homes of many of my relatives, eating dinner, especially on Sunday, was always preceded by individuals quoting scripture. Despite the alluring aroma that kept pulling at every one of your taste buds, you could not partake of the meal until everyone had quoted a verse. So the Bible was central to my development in the faith. In fact, we used to sing a song, the B-I-B-L-E, yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. But the Bible was not just a book of the church or a guide for personal devotion. It was the book of the movement. When we stood against social injustice, our stance had to be rooted in the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. Early on, my father made sure I knew there was no separation between Jesus and justice. This was not a matter of mere political ideology, but a central claim of our faith according to the authority of the B-I-B-L-E. I was taught that the Bible was the one book especially kept from the enslaved person and deliberately misinterpreted by the slave master. And so we were encouraged and pushed to read the Bible. We lived in one of the poorest regions of North Carolina. My parents challenged racism and economic injustice not just because they were unjust social realities, but also because the Spirit requires a quarrel with the world's injustices. They found this mandate in the pages of the B-I-B-L-E. I was taught Micah chapter 6, "What doth the Lord require but to do justice?" Isaiah chapter 58, "We are called to be repairers of the breach, to loose the bands of wickedness." Luke chapter 4, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach good news to the poor." Matthew chapter 25, "Inasmuch as you do to the least of these, you do it unto me." These were not just texts for memorization. They were the anchors around which an authentic Christian life must be centered. All of this happened long before I went to seminary and read the great sermons of Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. This was my foundation before someone determined that there are more than 2,000 scripture passages that speak to how we are called to treat the poor, the stranger, and those on the margins. Reading this book of devotions by Reverend Dr. Liz Theoharis and others takes me back to what I was taught about the centering position of the Bible for our communal and movement life together. I hope it also serves as a point of constant reflection for all those who will study it. This movement, called the Poor People's Campaign, is not a movement for any one faith or any one religious tradition, but it is a movement in which the BIBLE has a place. Our Sitz im Leben gives us a particular hermeneutic and exegesis. The Bible gives us courage in the midst of struggle and an authoritative critique above the false and distorted authority of the systems of injustices that create poverty and inequality. These reflections push us to re-examine, reimagine, and hear again the many great texts in the Bible that have something clear to say in our contemporary and continuing struggle for justice, truth, liberation, and love. The title itself, We Cry Justice, grows out of a phrase often placed on the lips of the ancient prophets. The prophets were often described as crying, crying out, crying loud, crying on behalf of God. This cry had at least two dimensions. One is the cry of weeping and hurt because of the conditions of injustice, poverty, and pain perpetrated by forces of empire and deception. Sometimes the prophets like Jeremiah would say, "Oh, that my head were a fountain of tears, that I might cry on behalf of Israel." Jesus, in the Gospels, is described as crying over the city of Jerusalem because it has left undone the weightier matters of justice and faith, choosing to kill prophets rather than hear them. This sounds strangely similar to America today. The other type of crying has the characteristic of a shout, a piercing yell that cuts through all of the noise of injustice and indifference. It is a blast like a trumpet sounding an alarm. God tells the prophet Isaiah to cry loud and spare not and to tell the nation of her sins. This is the way Martin Luther King Jr., Fannie Lou Hamer, and many others then and now cry for justice. We have so many criers like this in the Poor People's Campaign. For those of us in the faith, the Bible is not just a book. It is, as one hymn writer said, the mighty word of God. As you listen to this book and reflect on its contents, we invite you to join us in the Poor People's Campaign as we cry for justice. Bishop William J. Barber II, Doctor of Ministry, President and Senior Lecturer of Repairers of the Breach and Co-Chair of the Poor People's Campaign. Introduction. In a world broken by poverty, who does God call us to be, and what does God call us to do? In the United States, where nearly half of the population is poor or low income, a dominant distorted narrative blames the poor for their poverty. This narrative passes itself off as biblically rooted. But the good news of the poor proclaimed throughout the Bible rebukes political leaders and policies that degrade life, divide us from one another, and perpetuate the violence of poverty. Our sacred texts insist it is poverty rather than the poor that is immoral and sinful. We Cry Justice demonstrates what it means to be devoted to the God of liberation, not a theology of empire nor of systems that degrade and destroy life. The chapters in this book are embodiments of lives and a movement devoted to building a world free from poverty, systemic racism, militarism, and ecological devastation. Through the reflections in this book, and more importantly, through the leadership of the poor that has produced them, we express adoration to God and to God's commandments. We express our commitment to one another and dedication to building a movement to end injustice and to fight poverty, not the poor. Through sermons, protests, projects of survival, Bible studies, marches, songs, and more, we have devoted ourselves to God's work of liberation. These chapters are not just words on a page, but are actions and expressions of our love for God, for one another, and for the world that God desires for all people. The contributions in this book emerge from a movement seeking justice for all and rejecting the religion of empire. From Genesis to Revelation, our sacred texts teach us that poverty and injustice are not the will of God, and that it is the responsibility of all those who claim to honor and worship God to work to end systemic racism, poverty, and all forms of injustice. The contributors to this book read and write from the perspective of those who have been bruised and battered by empire. We have come forward to help establish God's empire, also called God's kingdom, basileia, reign, on earth as it is in heaven. After all, the founding story of the Bible is the exodus of people out of bondage, and the name God claims and proclaims is, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt." Exodus chapter 20, verse 2. The prophets remind those in power that God sides with the poor and judges those who add house to house and join field to field. Isaiah chapter 5, verse 8. The Gospels announce liberty to the captives, forgiveness of debts, a year of God's jubilee favor. Even Paul's epistles center on building up mutual solidarity among the poor. Indeed, in the biblical arc of justice, you see that we are challenged to be chaplains for a movement rather than priests of empire. The purpose of We Cry Justice is to provide strength, hope, and power for the more than 140 million poor and dispossessed people living in poverty in the midst of abundance, as well as to provide inspiration and guidance for those who stand with them. These devotionals are written by people in the struggle, many of whom are one storm, fire, healthcare crisis, or job loss away from deep poverty. In the words of Nick Smith, a fast food worker and Fight for $15 activist, reminding us of the preacher, activist, and theologian Howard Thurman, "Our backs are against the wall, and all we can do is push." Our hope is that these chapters will provide you with the spiritual nourishment to hold you through difficult days and the strength to sustain you in the movement to change the systems of injustice that have made us poor. The prayers, quotations, reflections, and passages offered in this book are by and for the least of these, which is most of us. We pray that you might find hope in our solidarity and our collective action. Our power as poor people depends on our ability to unite across difference, to believe in our capacity and call as moral leaders, and to speak to the nation out of shared moral and religious convictions. The chapters in We Cry Justice, which have grown out of the work of a movement, are useful for individual reading, collective prayer or Bible study, or political education or spiritual formation. They might inspire actions, posters, or speeches at protests, marches, rallies, or prayer vigils. These devotional offerings empower us for just that task. These reflections are written by those organizing through the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival, and related grassroots movements. The Poor People's Campaign is a diverse direct action movement organized in more than 40 states, anchored by the Kairos Center for Religions, Rights, and Social Justice at Union Theological Seminary and by Repairers of the Breach. Together, we are addressing the interlocking injustices of poverty, systemic racism, militarism and the war economy, ecological devastation, and the distorted moral narrative of religious nationalism. We are building power among poor and low-income leaders. Led by poor and dispossessed moral leaders on the front lines of struggle, the Poor People's Campaign puts forward solutions for ending poverty and its interlocking injustices. Clergy and other people of faith, activists and academics, serve as leaders within the campaign as well. Many of us are also poor and are organizing among the poor to end poverty. As a movement, we live a rhythm of themes, seasons that organize our collective life and work. These themes have guided our direct actions, political education, leadership development, and general work of ending poverty. This rhythm is captured in the 6 parts of this book. Part 1, Jubilee. Characterized by biblical stories and historical and contemporary examples in which every need is supplied, such as the Garden of Eden, manna in the wilderness, the practice of Jubilee, and life in the early Christian communities, this theme describes the anti-poverty programs that run throughout the Bible. The season of Jubilee parallels Pentecost, when God's Spirit was poured out onto a multiracial movement of Jesus followers, as well as the season just after Pentecost, often known as Ordinary Time. These biblical narratives do not just provide our moral justification that everybody has a right to live. They show us how that reality can be achieved in actions that ought to be ordinary in our lives and world. Part 2, Struggle and Lament. The Bible lifts up expressions of longing, mourning, and even anger at the way things are. More than 700 people die every day in the United States due to poverty. Millions of people in the United States die each year from inadequate health care. Crises in the form of pandemics, state-sanctioned violence, storms, and other disasters disproportionately affect the poor and people of color. In the richest country in human history, 140 million people are poor or just one emergency away from economic ruin. These are our people, our leaders, and our families, and we must mourn and wail and cry out to God for justice. The season of struggle and lament parallels the season of Lent in many Christian traditions. It is also a season in which the poor and dispossessed lament our struggles and call for the repentance of those who pursue policies and systems that are killing us. Part 3, The Days of Liberation. The story of Jesus' death and resurrection is the story of the state execution of an insurrectionist that ends in the triumph of God over the powers of death and destruction. This story of resurrection recalls the history of the Israelite people in the Exodus and other passages of liberation and salvation. In this season, the Days of Liberation, we celebrate the many examples in which the liberation of the oppressed has triumphed over forces of evil. This time celebrates the many ways that the poor today and throughout history have been victorious over the forces of oppression and death. Part 4, Learn as We Lead. Integral to the organizing and social change work of this movement is an understanding of praxis and leadership. As leaders of poor people's organizations, we learn through leading and lead through learning, knowing that our actions in movements for justice teach, draw from, and develop other leaders. Jesus led in much the same way. He was the leader of a poor people's movement, and in his work he linked teaching, leadership, and action. The liturgical season of Learn as We Lead acknowledges the necessity of education and leadership in building movements of the poor and dispossessed, throughout Scripture, throughout history, and in our work today. The biblical passages and devotional reflections offered in this liturgical season exemplify the organizing work of learning as we lead, talking as we walk. Part 5, The Advent of Revolution. Social movements and revolutions are built in stages. We see this throughout the Israelites' struggle for liberation and in the life and ministry of Jesus as he built a movement of the poor against the Empire of Rome. Texts that exemplify the stages of building a social movement characterize this season, the advent of revolution. They include the calls of the prophets, both biblical and contemporary, who demand radical revolution of values and prepare the way for transformation from the bottom up. Part 6, The Birth of a Movement. There are moments in every movement that mark the start of a new creation, a new process, a new organization, a birth of something new. In this season, we celebrate those moments in our collective histories, those moments in which we see clearly a rebirth toward liberation taking shape. In these times, we retell, again and again, the freedom stories, how the emergence of a moral movement unites people across difference, from the history of the Israelite people and the Jesus movement to our work today. This season connects with the season of Epiphany in many Christian traditions and the baptizing of leaders, welcoming them and the spirit of justice into the movement. The 53 chapters in this book can be used by individuals, families, congregations, and organizations. Individuals or families might use them as a weekly guide to reading scripture, reflecting, praying, and taking action around the particular theme of each devotional entry. Organizations and congregations may collectively study the biblical text in relationship to the principles and work of the Poor People's Campaign. Additionally, they can serve as inspiration for sermons, Bible studies, or protest speeches. Each chapter includes an opening quotation, a Bible verse or passage, a devotional reflection on that passage's meaning for the poor and dispossessed today, and prompts at the end for further reflection, reading, and prayer. Individuals or groups can focus on one entry each week over the course of a year. A suggested guide is outlined next. There are, however, many more possibilities for using the chapters. Groups and individuals should use what best fits their context. Please share the wisdom you find with others in the Poor People's Campaign and the larger movement to end poverty and racism. Suggested weekly reading structure. Each day, pray the prayer offered at the end of the entry. Sunday, listen and reflect on the passage of Scripture for the week. Monday, listen and reflect on the opening quotation. Find information about the leader and/or organization featured in the quotation to learn more. Tuesday, listen to the devotional reflection in the main body of the chapter. Wednesday, use the reflection questions to guide a solitary time of journaling or a group discussion. Thursday, listen to the additional suggested scripture readings and reflect on their relationship to the entry of the week. Friday, find information about the organizations and movements that the contributor is involved in. Pray for the author and the work of their organization. Saturday, consider what action you might take that is prompted by this week's chapter and reflection. Perhaps it's something to implement in your life or with your congregation or organization. Or perhaps it's supporting the author's organization with an offering, through prayer, with an encouraging message, or by participating in an action. We hope this book offers strength as you face the trials that systems of poverty, systemic racism, ecological devastation, and militarism have created. We pray these reflections, readings, and prayers inspire you to devote yourself again and again to building a better world for all, a world in which everyone is in and no one is out, just as God intended it. We pray that an understanding of the Bible as a basis of liberation might guide you. We call for a Christian faith that leads not to a distorted moral narrative upholding death-dealing systems, but to a truly abundant life. We invite you to become clear, committed, connected, and competent for the work of ending poverty and building a just world for all of God's children. We cry justice. Amen. Part 1. Jubilee. 1. Is ending poverty possible? Liz Theoharis. You only get what you're organized to take. Slogan of the National Union of the Homeless. Read Matthew chapter 26, verses 1 through 16. The poor you will always have with you is what Jim Wallace of Sojourners calls the most famous Bible verse on poverty. Matthew chapter 26, verse 11, takes place in the context of a meal with Jesus' disciples, during which a woman comes and pours an alabaster jar of ointment on his head. This anointing scene happens in the town of Bethany, whose name means house of the poor in Hebrew. It occurs directly after Jesus has turned over the tables and challenged the religious and political authorities for impoverishing people, and right before Judas betrays Jesus by turning him over for 30 pieces of silver to be crucified. With this action, the woman anoints Jesus. He becomes Christ, the Greek word for the anointed one in this scene. He is deemed Messiah, a ruler or prophet set apart by God to usher in a reign of justice. She is preparing him for his burial. But the disciples don't understand the significance of this anointing, nor of Jesus's impending execution at the hands of the state. The disciples criticize the woman for wasting, apolia, the Greek word for destroying, the ointment. Instead of breaking the jar and using it all, they say, the nard could have been sold for a year's salary and the money given to the poor. This idea of earning lots of money and giving the proceeds to the poor encapsulates how we often try to address poverty. Many Christians do charity work by buying and selling and then donating to the poor, but they never question how poverty was created in the first place. When Jesus says, the poor you will always have with you, he is quoting Deuteronomy chapter 15, which says that there will be no poor person among you if you follow God's commandments. Those commands include forgiving debts, releasing the enslaved, paying people fairly, and lending money even when you won't get paid back. Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 11, then, is essential. This verse claims that because people will not follow God's commandments, the poor will never cease to be in the land. Nowhere in this passage, nor in the entire Bible, does God condone poverty. Jesus is reminding us that God hates poverty and has commanded us to end it by forgiving debts, raising wages, outlawing slavery, and restructuring society around the needs of the poor. He is reminding the disciples that charity will not end poverty, but instead will keep it with us always. Jesus is reminding his followers that he will be killed for bringing God's reign here on earth, and that it is their responsibility to continue the quest for justice. And truly, poor people are continuing that quest. In June 2019, during a hearing of the Budget Committee of the House of Representatives, leaders of the Poor People's Campaign came to present what we've called the Poor People's Moral Budget. It's a study showing that the United States does have the money to end poverty, hunger, homelessness, and more. It's just that we do not have the political will to do so. The walls of that House committee room rang with empty words that twisted what the Bible says about the poor. One representative remarked that he had never found any place in the Bible where Jesus tells Caesar to care for the poor. Another suggested that Christian charity, not government-sponsored programs, is the key to alleviating poverty. In response, members of our racially and geographically diverse group pointed out how interesting it was that the first representative, a self-proclaimed follower of Jesus, identified himself with Caesar. We detailed many of the passages of Scripture that urge us to organize society around the needs of the poor. We did not end poverty in America that day, but one of our leaders, Aaron Scott, noted the power of what really happened. We staged a full-on narrative takeover, Scott commented. What I saw made it very clear that we have what it takes to force this government to atone for its sins. Reflect. What message do you hear about poverty from faith leaders and government authorities? What are the people of God called to do in the face of poverty from this passage? How are people responding to poverty today? What issues are of particular concern to you? Read Deuteronomy chapter 15, verses 1 through 4. This is the passage Jesus cites when he is anointed as Christ in this story. This scripture speaks to us about the role of laws and policies, rather than solely individual actions, in eradicating poverty. Pray. God of justice and life, we lift up to you 140 million of your people who are being abandoned in the midst of abundance. Grant us the wisdom, courage, and love to do your will, to organize society around the needs of the poor. May we strive to make earth as it is in heaven. Amen. 2. What we wish for. Solita Alexander Riley. I wish I could live like I'm longin' to live. Billy Taylor. I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. Read Deuteronomy chapter 15, 2 Corinthians chapter 6. We all carry so many wishes in our hearts. Some we utter aloud, and other wishes live on silently within us. One of my wishes is that we could all live free, joyful, and full lives. Yet so many of us who are poor are on the brink of despair. One reason? Debt. There is nothing like debt to undermine the strength of a society. Debt easily becomes insurmountable, impossible to pay off. People are crushed under the burden of medical, educational, and other kinds of debt. How many are not whole as a result? How many are healed but not restored, better skilled but not secure? Put simply, God's economy does not include debt and poverty. Instead, it introduces practices to prevent it. This is where Deuteronomy chapter 15 and 2 Corinthians chapter 6 suggest hope. These passages offer the impetus to break down what stands between us and true freedom. God has a different reality in mind and calls us to work toward a society in which full life is possible. Of the many laws set out in Deuteronomy, I wish we would take seriously the law described in chapter 15, the ritual practice of debt cancellation. In such times, an individual worked off what they owed to someone through enslavement or was forced into jail. Under these conditions, people could not fully participate in society. For this reason, in many societies of the ancient Near East, debts were canceled when a new leader took office, so that the leader's reign would not face challenge and insurrection from a populace under duress. This also secured the health of the society by ensuring that all could fully participate in society. Debt was deadly then, and it still is. How I wish debt cancellation were the law in our land. At the very least, we could apply the spirit of that law. As we see in Deuteronomy chapter 15, there is first the call for individual practices that make sure all needs are met. These verses instruct people to freely lend to those in need so there will be no poor among them. Charity and generosity have their place, but when people don't practice perfect charity and generosity, structural redress is necessary. So Deuteronomy chapter 15 calls for structural practices as well. There need to be laws ensuring that people don't fall into deeper and deeper debt. Deuteronomy's plan makes a routine by which everyone is restored as debts are canceled. Oh, how I wish we would be less confused about God's economy. Somehow we end up with laws that attach work requirements to our need for food, clothing, housing, and medical care for yourself and your children. You don't have what you need because you are lazy, the false narrative tells us. Structurally, our society has chosen the absurdity of poverty and the deadliness of debt. Thankfully, projects of survival, such as yesterday's Black Panther healthcare clinics, today's food programs, and other operations, stand in to circulate resources. Still, more is needed. Many of us wish for laws that guarantee jobs with living wages. We wish existing laws about affordable housing worked. We wish for health care for all. We wish to see the end of the school-to-prison pipeline and to see fully funded, equitable education instead. We wish for a tax structure that would make the wealthy and big businesses contribute their fair share of resources. We wish for money to come out of the military budget, out from our militarized police forces, and into our communities. We wish to live. All these wishes can become reality as we demand them. We are told in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 that now is the time. It is time to partner with God and with each other to create the world as God intends. It will not be easy, Paul tells us. We will endure much: riots, imprisonments, sleepless nights, hunger. If you are engaged in struggle, undoubtedly you have experienced some of these things. You may be characterized as poor, but you are incredibly powerful because what you are doing is building God's kingdom on earth. You are working with others and God to realize God's economy and to establish the principles of heaven right here and now. Reflect. You are powerful. What thoughts and feelings come up when you hear that truth? In what powerful ways are you addressing needs in your community? Are the laws and policies doing the same? How is God calling you to demand a fuller life for yourself and others? Read Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. The early Jesus community reminds us of the power of coming together to support the needs of our community. Pray. Loving God, thank you for setting forward a principle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.